Welcome to the age of the dinosaur. That's right, the dinosaur video cassette. I don't know if this is the world's largest video cassette, but it is one of them, if not the biggest video cassette ever made. And I am going to show you a recorder that I just picked up recently from eBay. It is a U-Matic Sony video cassette recorder model VO5600. This is a professional studio quality television broadcasting video cassette recorder. Now, by today's standards, since everything is HD, it is no longer broadcast quality because we've exceeded the quality of this machine. So we're past the 500 lines that it may have produced, but I don't even think this machine produced 500 lines. But it was really good, really sharp, and the cassettes are gigantic. Now, on my channel recently, we looked at a JVC S-type machine, which uses smaller cassettes, but it's in comparison to like VHS and VHS-C. So there was two different shell sizes, cartridge sizes, but it was the same tape on the inside. So this machine would be the VHS, not the VHS-C, that if you wanted to compare the two. And comparing the two cassettes themselves, this is a VHS tape sitting right in front of a U-Matic full-size cassette. So you can see it is much bigger, but it is much better quality than VHS was. So that's the cool part about it, is the quality of it. And you're seeing next to it there what we call press kits. I don't call them that. I happen to find them online and somebody else called them that. Press kits are video cassettes on the U-Matic format that were sent to studios like television stations to promote a particular movie. So in this case, I've got G-Force, Up, and episode 3, as well as what's this last one over here, Ponyo. So these were sent to television stations. They could use them in their news broadcasts and promote a movie and use them, get some B-roll footage and that sort of thing. So I'm going to show you those because I thought those were very unusual. I had never seen anything like that before. In fact, you can go on eBay now and find some of those press kits, and they're in like beta format. What is it, the digital beta cam, something like that. So they came out in different formats, not just U-Matic, but I just happen to have some U-Matic ones here. In fact, there's some VHS ones out there as well. So let's dive into this machine. I'll show you some of its features. We'll take the hood off and look at the gigantic parts on the inside. And I think you'll notice that it looks kind of like Betamax on the inside. In fact, I've read that this format was the predecessor to Betamax, and it was based on this format. So there may be a reason for that. Anyway, let's get started. Starting at the top left, you'll see what is common on professional video cassette recorders is VU meters, volume unit meters for audio levels, and there's little level controls underneath. And apparently that's the best setting, and that's the best setting because somebody marked on there with a pen or a pencil. But if you didn't want to have to do a manual level control, you could just turn on the audio limiter and get auto controls on those volumes. We got a tracking control here with a little, you know, place in the middle where it kind of stops. So that's pretty cool. And then you got a headphone jack here. You got audio monitor for your headphone jack. You can do channel 1, channel 2, or a mix. You got some quarter-inch jacks here for your headphones, of course, and for two microphones. Then over here you have an input select, so you can hook in a TV or a line. Your standard controls here are eject, stop, all these normal ones. Got an audio dub for channel 1, as well as a record button there. And you have pause. And then over here we've got some special functionality, very similar to the Betamax X1 machine you saw on my channel. And it has the ability to start and repeat at the zero counter setting. So you just, you know, zero your counter, get it where you want it to on the tape, and it'll just play from zero and rewind and play from zero again once it reaches the end of the tape. Or you can just have it completely rewind and come back to zero and stay there. So that's kind of a cool thing as well. So you got rewind and repeat, programmed operation. Then you have reverse and forward, which is kind of like your fast scan, reverse scan. And then you've got a timer switch over here so you can have it do certain things once power has been applied to it, either record or play or no timer at all. There's your power switch. You have a skew button here, which I believe has to do with the tape tension. And I did have to use that recently on a tape that I played on there. It took some like rainbow colors off the screen. So that'll give you a roundabout view of the front there. Huge space here, front loader. And you got a little tray there that your tape loads into, and tape goes into the machine here. You can see the video head in the center of your screen there. We'll get a closer view of that here shortly. But now, before we go into the machine and see what's inside, let's go ahead and take a look at one of these press kits, and I think you'll be surprised at what's included with them. So a friend of mine who is in broadcasting and has a lot of experience with broadcast machinery as well as the tapes told me to watch out for Ampex tapes, and he wasn't kidding. I showed you guys some of the tapes I got in my last video with the JVC, and three out of the five tapes were bad. One of them was bad because it was an Ampex, and the tape is just tight and it won't move and has all kinds of issues with it. But in this case, I'm dealing with Sony tape, and Sony tape is pretty good. So in fact, you can see it right up here, Sony KSA-60BRST anti-static cassette. And what we're looking at here is the Pano electronic press kit, and it says see enclosed log. Has a total playing time of 37 minutes 55 seconds. I was surprised that this was still used in 2000. The year 2000, which is one of the tapes I had, was dated that. But look at that, 2009, we were still using these things. So let's look around here. There's a label here on the back of the lid of the Amore case, if you want to call it that. So we got Walt Disney Pictures Pano electronic press kit. It's got a trailer. It's got a featurette, sound bites, B-roll selects, film clips, three of those. Pretty cool. Comes with this little handout here from Walt Disney Studios Motion Pictures. It's got a little letter in here, dear broadcaster, etc., etc. And then it's got the information about the movie and its credits there. And then once again, a layout of what's on the tape and in what order. So that's pretty much what a press kit looks like. I think in some cases press kits would have like, I don't know, pictures, you know, like little cards that had pictures of the characters in it, or it might have had a folder with more information in it. But this is what the press kit looks like here. Now, the Star Wars one I got, the Episode 3, that one, I'll grab it here real quick. That one didn't come with anything real special with it, but I was really excited to see this. Of course, hey, it can include some Jedi action on here. That's the thing that they really emphasized in this little mini documentary that they have on here, is how much action and fighting is in this movie. But there's the tape itself. Little rundown of what's on it there under the lid. And this one, I can't tell what brand it is. It doesn't appear to be a Sony, but it played really well. I'll play a little bit of it for you here in a little bit, but it plays just fine. So there's a little disclaimer underneath the lid here. So you got to agree not to sell it or, you know, play it with, you know, in an unauthorized broadcast way, you know, so... The guy on eBay that sold me these, he's probably going to jail as a result of selling these to me. But anyway, so that's pretty cool. There's two of them there, and hope you find those interesting. Before we get into the inside, let's look at the back side. And here's the jacks on the back. And this one's really simple. There's really not a lot here. You got a BNC connector for your video in, and you got your audio in there. Then you got an audio monitor plug right there, and then you've got RCA outputs there, which is what I'm using for my home theater setup here. And then I've got there's an RX data jack down there. So I am using a BNC to RCA adapter for the video out. There is an RF out, and there's one of those old school TV monitor outputs. So there's like televisions that were used in television studios, and you could plug that in there. And then you got this remote select switch here, 300 and 400/500. Not real sure what that is, but I'll bet you somebody can leave a comment and tell us what that does. There's a remote connector here. Now, I'm pretty sure what that was is an interface for a console so that you could hook two of these machines together and do edits and playback and that kind of stuff and control it remotely. It's got a big old fat power cord on it. Probably draws, I think this thing draws 60 watts of power. I think that's what I read on it. So yeah, uses a little bit of juice. All right, next, inside. I am now up on the rooftop of my house, peering over the edge so I can get back far enough to give you a bird's eye view of the inside of this VCR. Okay, really it's not quite that big, but it's pretty big. So let's kind of do what we usually do here on the databits channel. We'll kind of zoom in and look around inside of here. We've got some stacked circuit boards here on the left side, and we move around to the back there, and I don't know, that's probably a power supply right there. And let's see, what does it say on there? It's got a model number and part number, serial number, all that kind of stuff. Moving over here to the actual playback part of the unit there, there is the gigantic video drum, and it appears to be only two heads because I only see a wire set there and a wire set there. So if we kind of zoom down here on the side, we'll spin it around and see. Okay, there's a head there. And we'll spin it around. There's the second one there. So, yep. So there's your video head. And typically, if you find one of these and it doesn't work, it very well could need a new video head, which would be this piece here. Or it could need belts. And there are several belts on the inside of this unit as well. There is a little belt right down here. And that belt is part of what drives this circular ring track here that loads the film into there, or the, not the film, but the tape. And then there is a rubber tire down here that drives your take up and supply spindles. And there's a pinch roller, might need a new pinch roller if it happens to be wore out, depending on how many hours are on the thing. And there's your pickup audio head there and a race head paired together there. Wanted to show you that there's some cool red LED lights in here. So when I power it up, you'll see these lights light up here. There's a set there on that side and a set over there on that side. And apparently those are what look at the film, or the tape, I should say. I keep saying film. Look at the tape to determine whether or not it is there or not. And if it sees through and detects that there's an end of tape, then changes its functionality accordingly. Now with the light turned on, as I insert the tape, you're going to see it pull out some of the tape and just hold it out here, basically in front of the video head drum right there, and but not completely wind it in. So it just takes out enough tape that it needs to be able to do some of the regular functions. Let's do a eject on it and let you see that again. You see how it whipped the tape right back inside the cartridge there. Okay, see that a little bit better. All right, so now I'm going to turn my camera around and let's go ahead and hit play and watch how it winds the tape around all the pulleys and stuff in there. Pretty cool what's going on right here when I hit play right there. Let's see it again. There's stop. See that little lever move out of the way? It's like it knows what it's supposed to do. Then I'm gonna hit play again. You can see that the capstan pinch roller kind of punch right in there. All right, and then let's try it again here. Let's hit stop. And then let's hit play again. So you can see where the U from the U-Matic comes into play here. The U is from here to here. So the U shape is the basically going around the video head drum right there. And then wraps around in a U shape. So very interesting the way it works. We are actually in play mode right now. So It's just amazing how many pulleys and guides it takes to get this job done here, and how the tape is just kind of hanging out there on these little, just little white pulleys, just to get it wrapped around there. It's kind of crazy. All right, so let's go ahead and hit stop again. See what that looks like from this angle. I made somebody laugh in one of my previous videos because I said this little track down here, and you can see the track being pulled by that gear in the center of your screen, that this little track reminded me of a choo-choo train track, and he thought that was pretty hilarious. So yeah, it is kind of like that. It's it has a little track that it runs on there. You can see the train just went around the track there. I didn't see a caboose on the end there, but definitely got the job done. So the tape is wider than regular VHS tape. That's one of the things that's also fascinating about it, is just how thick that tape is. All right, and then let's go ahead and hit eject and watch it whip the tape back in there. All right, so now we want to see it actually play. What does the quality of the video look like? Well, I'm going to put it up on my plasma TV here and kind of give you an idea of what it looks like, and hopefully doesn't make any copyright people mad, but hey, we'll find out. So as is quite common with these U-Matic studio tapes, is you get color bars at the beginning as well as a tone, and I'll turn the volume up here so you can hear the tone. And when you do a visual search, you also get an audio search. So I'm going to fast forward it there and hit play. And then we'll just kind of see the credits here at the beginning of this tape. This is the Episode 3 Star Wars Press Kit U-Matic tape. Okay, there we go. So then displays the contents of the tape, and there are no chapter stops, so there's no way to actually access these except to fast forward through them, scan through the tape, find the portion that you're looking for. So then as it hits each segment, it comes up and kind of gives you a suggested anchor intro. So your anchor at your news station says all this, and then you play this next part here. Channel 1 has DME, and the other side, Channel 2, is narration. So it's not actually stereo. Turn it up a little bit here.
Obi-Wan Kenobi give Luke Skywalker his father's lightsaber. Lightsabers and action have been the hallmarks of Star Wars movies. With the release of Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, the action-packed adventures of the Jedi Knights reach a new level of intensity.
There's non-stop action in it. I'm finding to my physical peril, it's ridiculous how much action there is in it.
Writer-director George Lucas says creating the wall-to-wall action in Revenge of the Sith wasn't easy.
So there's a pause. Look at the look on that guy's face. That was a really good place to stop, wasn't it? All right, and then let's see, what else can I show you? I can rewind. Then I can hit play.
Adventures of the Jedi Knights reach a new level of intensity.
There's non-stop action in it. I'm finding to my physical peril, it's ridiculous how much.
So that is pretty much what that one looks like. Let me go ahead and pop another one in for you so you can see a little bit of it. So now we're looking at the Ponyo tape. As you can see, looks pretty good. We're getting a little bit of strange effects there with the difference between my TV and this camera. But it looks pretty good there. And I can hit pause on it here. So there's pause, not too bad. It's a little freaky when you hit play, kind of goes crazy. Let's see here, turn the sound up.
Tina Fey, Betty White, Clarice Leachman, Lily Tomlin, Matt Damon, and Kate Blanchett.
Another thing I really like about this U-Matic player is the fact that it has a mirror as well as a couple of lights in there to allow you to see the label inside as well as see the supply spindle so that you can take a look and see how much tape you have left. So if I carefully lift the little front door out of the way there, you can see that supply spindle right there, and you can see the label, and of course it's reflecting off of the mirror that's hanging down inside of there. So I suppose if you put the letters in there mirrored and backwards, you could read it a little bit better. But it does work pretty well, and it's kind of an exciting feature. It'd be cool to replace those old incandescent lights in there with LEDs. And that will conclude our video for today, looking over these press kit videos that I have here. What a treat to find something like that as pre-recorded material to play on this machine. I didn't think you would find anything like that. I thought it would be like, you know, just old commercials or some kind of studio material, maybe newscasts or something that you would find on these tapes. Or, you know, who knows, you might have to make your own tapes in a lot of circumstances, record from Laserdisc or something to it, from DVD. But in any case, this has been really fun. It's been an adventure for me to get to learn U-Matic and experience it. This VCR really is gigantic. It's huge. It's like, I don't know, ridiculous. It's like two Laserdisc players stacked on top of each other with room to spare. So especially in the depth part of it, it's really deep. But anyway, thank you for watching. Please share this video with a friend and subscribe to my channel. And we will see you on the next video here on the databits channel.